ZELLA-101 was a phase one dose escalation study of alvocidib followed by conventional 7+3 induction. Alvocidib is a cyclin-dependent kinase 9 inhibitor. It's actually a multi-cyclin-dependent kinase inhibitor with the highest potency against CDK9. CDK9 forms a complex with cyclin T1 called PTEF-beta. PTEF-beta thereby recruits or is recruited to super enhancer complexes and regulates the activity of RNA polymerase 2, which thereby transcribes genes notable for cell survival, such as MCL1 and c-MYC. So alvocidib really downregulates and suppresses MCL1 activity. We have previously studied alvocidib in the context of a timed sequential chemotherapy regimen where alvocidib was given followed by cytarabine and mitoxantrone. This was otherwise known as FLAM or ACM. Flavopiridol is the old name for alvocidib. And we noted clinical activity with the FLAM timed sequential therapy regimen in both newly diagnosed and relapsed refractory AML. But alvocidib has not been combined with conventional 7+3 induction to date. So the purpose of this study was to determine whether it was safe and feasible to administer alvocidib followed by 7+3, and B, to determine whether there's clinical activity of this regimen and whether this can be should be studied further in drug development. We noted that alvocidib was safe. We were able to escalate the dose and did not achieve a maximal tolerated dose. So the highest dose level studied was consistent with our prior published studies of alvocidib followed by cytarabine and mitoxantrone. We escalated alvocidib to 30 milligrams per meter squared as an initial bolus, followed by 60 milligrams per meter squared over 4 hours. And this was given over 3 consecutive days, days 1 through 3, prior to 7+3 induction, which began on day 5. We utilized 60 milligrams per meter squared of daunorubicin on this study. And we excluded those with APL or core binding of factor AML, which is the favorable risk cytogenetic subgroup of AML. 32 patients enrolled on this study, 23 of whom were enrolled on the expansion maximal tolerated dose or highest dose level studied of the 30 milligrams per meter squared followed by 60 milligrams per meter squared of alvocidib. The main severe side effects that we saw in the study were also consistent with what we've previously seen with the time sequential therapy regimens of alvocidib. Diarrhea and tumor lysis syndrome really seem to be the most common severe toxicities with this regimen. The diarrhea is usually very rapid after the first dose. It's a secretory diarrhea, and it's very well managed with supportive care antidiarrheals. And tumor lysis syndrome is predominantly laboratory-based and able to be mitigated with rigorous monitoring and IV fluids and so forth. There is only one grade 4 tumor lysis syndrome. The other incidences were grade 3 and predominantly laboratory-based and self-limiting. Overall, we saw notable clinical activity. This is a very high-risk subgroup of patients. As I mentioned, we excluded favorable risk cytogenetics. And within the safety population, the overall CR rate was 69%. However, there was one patient who had an early death due to septic shock, and so that patient was not evaluable for response. And excluding that patient, we saw an overall complete remission rate of 71%. All of whom obtained full hematologic recovery. So there was no incomplete recovery within the complete remission of patients. We also saw notable activity in high-risk subgroups of patients such as secondary AML, AML with MDS-related changes, where 50% of each of those subgroups achieved CR within the overall safety population, and the response evaluable population was 60% CR rate in those with secondary AML and 55% with AML with MDS-related changes. This study has relatively short follow-up, so we were not able to obtain median survivals, relapse-free survival or event-free survival, but the durability of remissions certainly seems encouraging. Lastly, I think one of the interesting aspects is to decipher biomarkers of response to alvocidib within this regimen. We looked at both genomic biomarkers and some ongoing correlates involving MCL1 dependence and activity. The MCL1 dependence correlates are ongoing at this time and will not be presented at the EHA conference, but we did note that those with spliceosome mutations and other poor risk mutations like RUNX1 and ASXL1 had very high complete remission rates and very encouraging clinical activity with this regimen. And so this data suggests really that a very poor risk subpopulation of patients may benefit from the addition of alvocidib to this regimen.